my favorite Sun Records artists. The first time I heard it, I was probably about 12 years old. Jerry Lee Lewis.
Jerry Lee.
The first time I heard Great Balls of Fire, it changed my world. I listened to it yesterday, and it still gets me going.
The killer.
There's a reason why they call him that. It was so dangerous. Like, you sit there and you listen to, like, Great Balls of Fire or Breathless or any other song.
High school cover. A whole lot of shaking going on.
Imagine being in the 50s and that coming on. It was so dangerous. You want to talk about punk rock? Jerry Lee Lewis.
Oh, yeah.
Is the godfather, the great, great, great godfather of punk rock music. Definitely. And the attitude of punk rock. Is he a very likable guy?
He's also a scumbag.
He's a scumbag.
He is our prisoners of rock and roll shitbag of the week. So my notes, the first bullet point of my notes here says, he's an asshole.
Absolutely.
But goddamn, can he play piano.
It's amazing.
God just gave him this gift. I'll keep on going on for hours, but hands down, my favorite Sun Records.
He was like a session musician for Sun, and he's on a whole lot of hits. And they said he wanted to start doing his own stuff, and he was doing, I think, a whole lot of shaking going on, because that's a cover. Mm-hmm. And somebody was like, this is a rock and roll label, Sun. You can't do no country music. And so he amped it up.
Yeah.
And it's and also fun fact, in Great Balls of Fire, the woo that he does.
Yeah.
That is where Ric Flair got his
Got
his inspiration. That's where that came from. It's a Jerry Lee Lewis thing.
I didn't know that.
Everybody's going to know a couple of those songs. Rock music at that time just didn't have piano in it. Other than I couldn't think of another musician that was famous in rock and roll music with the piano other than Fats Domino. So why don't we just play 30 seconds, a whole lot of shaking going on. And
so much energy.
And that's a cover song.
Yeah.
And I think,
is it?
I think a lot of these, couple of these songs are covers that
everybody covered everybody back then.
Yeah, but he made it his own. He pulled it forward so far.
Yeah.
And nobody has ever sounded like him.
I don't think anybody who recorded afterwards doesn't know it's a cover.
I didn't know until it was a cover.
Yeah, that's amazing.
Until I was doing the notes.
What a way to come out and make an album. Say a whole lot of shaking going on. Back in the 50s, that was so seductive. So seductive.
Yeah. You're thinking about like cars going back. Like, what's going on? Oh, a whole lot of shaking's going on.
Yeah.
And Ryan, you mentioned before about just like the heaven just open up and things just go that way. It's just like,
the right place, the right time.
This dude is, he's kind of tooling around. He's a session musician with all these famous people around him. And he takes a swing at doing something different, and it just blows up.
But besides piano playing, his voice is unique. You know, even though that has had the country and the boogie-woogie, he created something that only he could have done.
And he was really religious, Jerry Lee Lewis.
He's going to be a preacher.
His cousin is
Jimmy Swagger, right?
Yeah.
Well, I didn't know that that was his cousin.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah. They were both in Bible school together.
Yeah. Oh, really?
They were both going to be preachers.
So they said that when he was writing this music, he felt really dirty.
He felt the devil in him.
He was writing such like sexual.
Even later in life, he was like, I'm going to hell, boy.
Yeah.
He was like, I did the devil's work.
Yeah, he did.
And even as I just said that, there was something, everything about him in that is sexual. The way he's dancing and moving and he's banging on, like,
you know,
it's just possessed.
Yeah.
He is to piano as Chuck Berry is to the guitar.
You know, there's a story that Chuck Berry would not follow Jerry Lee. And Jerry Lee was like, all right, you want to follow the killer? You can follow the killer. So he goes out there in front of Chuck Berry and puts the piano on fire, like a blaze. He gets lighter fluid and blazes up the piano.
Is that like the first time he did it?
That was the first time he did it. He only did it a couple of times.
He did this, and then he was like, this was the stupidest thing I ever did. And the guy was like, no, this is the most brilliant thing you ever did. And he walked off stage, and he was like, follow that.
I never knew that that was the story of where that came from. That's like Pete Townshend smashing all the smashing the guitars and everything.
Yeah. Well, he was on the Steve Allen show, and it's like, you know, Steve Allen always said like is the best guest he ever, like Elvis was on Steve Allen and this and that. But you can find on YouTube of Jerry Lee on Steve Allen. And in the background, you know, Jerry Lee stands up and kicks the chair out and everything like that. And you see behind him, Steve Allen, you see this chair just flying to the other side, like behind him, like right out of wrestling. Woo! It was just madness.
The music just made him do it.
Yeah, music make people do crazy things, man. You know,
and that's rock and roll.
That is rock and roll. Bring down the house.
Rock and roll did not make him marry his cousin.
No,
Jerry Lee. And that's why he's...
He's got...
He's an asshole for a lot of reasons. And if you talk to any music journalist, critic... Yeah.
I wish I would have saw him in concert. A few of my friends saw him a few years ago, and the pictures were amazing of him. Like, he came out, did like three songs, and he's like, I'm the killer, I'm out of here.
Where was that at?
It was in Vegas.
Oh, that's right. I remember... Oh, man.
Yeah,
I would have loved
it. It was awesome.
The Stray Cats played that show, too.
Yeah.
Can you imagine that show? That'd be really cool,
seeing the Stray Cats.
And Jerry Lee. I could do three songs, and I'm out.
Thank you for $150. No. Good night!
$150. Like $150,000.
And he's still alive. He's like, he's in his mid-80s now.
Yeah. And the IRS is still following him around.
Yeah. That's why he only did three songs. He had to get out of Dodge. He defected to Ireland.
He
left the country and went to Ireland to evade tax evasion.
He was really blowing up. He was on tour in England and was given a press conference or something, and the only reporter that showed up to talk about him found out that he married his 13-year-old cousin.
And then he came home and nobody went on the
And that just kind of the bottom fell out.
Yeah, they blacklist them.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, rightfully so. I'm sure down south, and that was just the way it happens. Like, people married cousins. But in the north, and civilized people, as people are socialites, whatever you want to call them, that wasn't acceptable.
Yeah, yeah, it is not. I mean, you're a celebrity, and next thing you know, you think mom and dad want their 14-year-old daughter to listen to his songs and thinking they're going to marry.
Right. Yeah. He's probably already considered dangerous for all of the way he moved and he danced and the music.
I think nobody was safe.
He's lighting shit on fire, and then, and he's marrying his 14-year-old. Right, his 14-year-old cousin.
Ugh. And I think it was like his cousin was his bass player, and it was his daughter. So he married his bass player's 14-year-old daughter. That's his cousin.